Good morning and welcome to the first meeting in 2023 of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. We've received apologies from Colin Beattie this morning, so as Deputy Chair, I will be chairing the meeting in his absence. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We're all agreed. Our next agenda item today is to take evidence on Audit Scotland's annual report and accounts for the year to 31st March 2023, as well as the auditor's report on the accounts. A welcome to the meeting this morning, Alan Alexander, Chair of the Board of Audit Scotland, Stephen Boyle, Auditor General for Scotland, Vicky Bibby, Chief Operating Officer, Martin Walker, Director of Corporate Support, and Stuart Dennis, Corporate Finance Manager, Audit Scotland. And I'd like to start by inviting Professor Alexander and then the Auditor General to make short introductory statements.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning to you and to your colleagues on the Commission. As I don't have to remind you, Scotland is dealing now with a range of highly significant issues, both long-standing and recently emerging. These include growing inequalities, demographic change, rising demand for public services, social and economic recovery from the pandemic, and a cost of living crisis that has emerged and has developed with dizzying speed over the last year or so. These issues have combined to exacerbate the problems facing Scotland's public services, its decision makers and its communities. The lesson that we take from our year's work is that Scotland's public services need to change. It was a recurring finding throughout Audit Scotland's work in 22-23, and Stephen will have rather more to say about that. In this context, it was the right time for the Auditor General, the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland to consider our purpose and how we can have a positive impact on services and on the people of Scotland. During this financial year, we consulted with our stakeholders, including yourselves, to inform and shape our shared vision and mission and the outcomes we want to achieve for Scotland. We published the results last Tuesday in the form of our refreshed statement of purpose, public audit in Scotland, which is supported by Audit Scotland's new corporate plan. We were impressed by the degree to which there was a common view about what Audit Scotland should be doing across our range of stakeholders. As an organisation, Audit Scotland has also had to navigate the issues I've been talking about. Like other public bodies, the cost of living crisis and recovery from the pandemic have had an impact on us and continue to do so. We're making good progress and have performed well in 22-23, but it hasn't been easy and we still have work to do. Over the past year, Audit Scotland has bedded in its new leadership team. Our new executive directors have been in post for about 12 months. Vicky Bibby joined us in August last year as Chief Operating Officer. The Audit Scotland board has been impressed with the dynamism, energy and quality of this leadership team. This is already bearing fruit in the innovation and the focus on ensuring Audit Scotland can continue to deliver high quality work, meet current and future needs and lead public audit at a time of such stress on the public finances. My board has continued to discharge its duties and oversee Audit Scotland through these changes. The well-informed and positive challenge that we bring to the board has, I believe, contributed to the process by which the new leadership team has led the work of Audit Scotland. And I thank my fellow members, both the statutory members and my fellow independent members, for their hard work and their collegial approach throughout the year. I would particularly, Chair, like to thank Stephen, the Auditor General and Accountable Officer. He's led Audit Scotland during a period when just getting the organisation through would have constituted a strong performance. But he's gone further. He's proactively tackled future challenges and put into motion the work needed to ensure that public audit remains fit for purpose, relevant and effective now and in future years. Let me conclude by paying tribute, as I always do, to Audit Scotland staff. I've remarked before on their professionalism, their can-do attitudes and their good humour. And I remain struck by all of this, and I thank them for all their work. Let me now hand over to Stephen to give his introduction. Stephen.
Many thanks, Alan. Good morning, Chair. Good morning, Commission members. Chair, for some time there have been questions and warnings about the sustainability of Scotland's public services and the need for reform. Audit Scotland has been at the forefront of some of those messages. Our work in 2022-23 reinforces the need for sustainable change. Reforms are needed in how public services are delivered, and we believe that we're beyond the stage where incremental changes and adjustments are enough. Decision makers and public bodies need to reconsider delivery models, how they work in partnership, and crucially, how they involve the public in this process. And this needs to be matched with better transparency around public spending and the decisions being made. Over the past year, myself, the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland have taken a close look at what we are contributing. How are we driving, advocating for and supporting change? How can we promote and uphold more clarity around public finances? And what is the positive impact that we can have on the lives and outcomes of Scotland's people? The themes of delivery, change and transparency are also at the heart of Public Audit in Scotland and our corporate plan. They provide salient reference points for discussing our performance in 2022-23. Chair, the bedrock of our work is delivering timely, impactful and high-quality audits. Last year, we delivered 51% of annual audits to deadline. Auditors continue to work towards bringing back audits to pre-pandemic timelines, but this is challenging. Based on current tracking, our recovery plan is on course to return over the next 2 to 3 years to 2019 levels. We have made good progress with audit quality. This year, independent external review found that all of the reviewed performance audits and 80% of the reviewed financial audits met the expected standards. Over the past 2 years, we have implemented a quality improvement programme alongside existing assurance processes. During 2022-23, we embedded our innovation and quality group to support high quality work across the organisation. This was one part of the organisational change we have undergone. The SCPA has supported our staffing and capacity requests in recent years, and we added 14.5 whole-time equivalents in the past year. But like all other audit and accountancy organisations, we face strong competition for high-quality candidates. We continue to ensure that we provide a unique and compelling blend of rewarding work, career development, a supportive culture, flexibility and the opportunity to do work that makes a positive impact to people's lives. Lastly, Chair, I will turn to the transparency of our financial position. We met our financial targets in challenging circumstances. As with all other organisations, both public and private, we faced the impact of inflationary pressures on our costs. In conjunction with our trade union partners, we agreed a fair pay deal for staff, but one that was higher than budgeted. Through prudent management and efficiencies, we have absorbed this additional expenditure in the year. Chair, at the heart of everything we've done over the past year has been the resilience, professionalism and empathy of my Audit Scotland colleagues. Like Alan has said, they continue to support each other through delivering high quality audit work, and I can't thank them enough. Chair, all five of us look forward to answering the Commission's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you for that, and I'll now open up to questions from members. Can I bring in Daniel Johnson first?
Thank you very much, Convener. Professor Alexander, I think, set out the context that everyone is operating in very well. The cost of living crisis is still with us. Inflation is remaining stubborn at 10%, I think much to the surprise of various forecasters. And yet, in terms of your total resource requirement, that was £1 million under what was forecast. I think that in and of itself is somewhat surprising. I was just wondering if, Stephen, you could set out kind of why that is. My understanding is the majority of that is about staff underspend. But again, given the pay pressures, again, I think that may find that surprising. Indeed, are there thresholds that you apply to the forecasts in terms of underspending? If you could just talk us through both why and how you go about the forecasts and whether they were correct.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Johnson. Thanks for that question. All of that context that you've said we recognise and has been a feature of our financial management over the course of the year. I'm going to bring in a couple of colleagues, actually, maybe bring Stuart in a moment, just to kind of set out for the Commission the breakdown of our underspend and some of the intricacies of that. Some of it is cash, some of it's non-cash, parts of it are Dell and other bits Amy, so there's a combination of factors. And then some of them, maybe invite Vicky to speak a bit further about just the management of the staffing budget. Before passing to colleagues, one thing I would add is that, as the Commission knows, Audit Scotland, our key financial target is fundamentally to break even each year. So unlike some other public bodies, we're not able to carry reserves to smooth our financial position from one year to the next, just a feature of how we operate as an organisation. And that means that we have to plan really quite carefully to break even. There are a number of variables, quite rightly you mentioned our staffing costs. One of the others that's worth highlighting for the Commission is our revenue recognition or our work in progress. So Audit Scotland's, you know, we account for income really as our audits progress. The audit year, to add complexity to this, doesn't coincide exactly with the financial year either. So audits tend to run from, you know, there's a varying financial year ends, but from October to September. So when we strike the accounts at the end of March, there's an in-year position. We take that. That's a real risk that we have to manage really carefully, the work in progress. And Stuart and Vicky also really kind of monitor that closely through weekly reporting, actually, as we move towards the end of the year. That's fundamentally context, Mr. Johnson. I think it would be helpful, maybe through Vicky, first of all, just to see like the staffing position, and then perhaps pass to Stuart to set out the detail of the underspend. Vicky.
Thank you, Stephen. Yeah, just in context to that, the actual operating underspend we've got is nearer 200,000. The rest of it, and Stuart will go into the detail, this year it's there's been significant adjustments because of the pension and the rest of position. We've got a funded scheme. We are part of the local government pension scheme. And so the impact of that underspend largely relates to pension adjustments. Half of it is Amy, and 300,000 of that is Dell, and Stuart will go into more detail. So our actual operating underspend is nearer the 200,000, which is 1.2% of our budget. And as Stephen says, given our target to break even and the challenges we've got of matching income into our budget, I think the board, when we discussed it, were quite satisfied that that is a reasonable variable to our budgeted position. Staff turnover this year is higher for a number of, the vacancy factor is a bit higher for a number of reasons. We've had some retirements as a result of the year end, and there's been a number, including the senior executive team, of taking time on the budget to actually have the full year costs. So that's resulted in an underspend on some of the staff costs, which we expect to not be replicated going into 23-24. So that, I'll pass over to Stuart for the detail, but our actual operating underspend is nearer the 200,000 rather than the million. But I'll pass over to Stuart.
Thanks, Vicky. Yeah. You'll probably see from, I think, page 32 of the report, there's a detail of the actual variance analysis. So when it comes to people costs, we show a 1.3 million underspend. But what that relates to is half a million of that is actual controllable costs, so that's staff costs, and that's due to turnover, as Vicky was saying there. Half a million relates to Amy funding in respect of the funded pension scheme, so that's an actuary calculation that we have to account for on that basis. And 0.3 million relates to, is also an actuary report that relates to the unfunded pension scheme. So out of the controllable spend, we were at half a million underspent in people costs. but other operating expenditure, we were also below budget by 0.1 million. But included in there is our management contingency budget. So that is used to offset and in year, of which we have half a million. So we had 0.3 million of an underspend there. So we were under pressures in respect of other budget headings in respect of IT, training and recruitment, and property costs were higher than budgeted. So, but overall, we ended up within other operating expenditure 0.1 million below budget. And on top of that, we then have fees and expenses paid to firms that is included in there. So that was 0.2 million more than planned, but a lot of that will be offset by additional income that we would get charged out. So that would be the firms would probably charge more for the audit due to the complexity and various things, and we would then recharge that out to the audited body and recover that. So as the Auditor General said, and Vicky, the work in progress is a risk area that we look to manage, and that's part of the reason why the income side of things we're 2.2 million below our budget there. Obviously we managed to come out overall, and the bottom line was 0.2 million in operating costs, but the income side of things, we can only recognise the income for the amount of work we've actually done on starting the new audits. And I think there's two factors there. There's a factor that this is the first year of the new audit appointments, so that onboarding of that can take a while. So this is where we rotate the auditors around, and that will be some that we would have done in-house would now be done by the firms and the other way around. So there can be an element of delay in that. And also, as the Auditor General said, it's a difficult challenge at the minute to try and catch up. So we did in the budget look to catch up an element, and that is a reason as well that we hadn't recovered sufficient income that we were planning to budget. But overall, this is very closely managed with all the challenges throughout the year, I would say, with particular focus coming in the final quarter, just to make sure that we can come in with a break-even position.
So can I just follow up? So Vicky, you said that the vacancy rate is higher than kind of the long term or your target. What is it, or has it been over the last year?
So the vacancy factor, sorry, it's right. I'll get the page here. Our people. It is a bit. We're about 80. Apologies, I should have had that. It's in our.
Tell you what, I just wonder if there is a recruitment retention issue that you have, and that's underspent. Because I mean, I also note that your recruitment figures, recruitment spend, was over budget, and then when I also look at the median salary, it's only 2% higher in the year just gone compared to the previous year. Now, if I layer all the different things that we've alighted on, this cost of living. You know, we've got a very tight labour market. If you've only increased salaries by 2%, and you're also having to, you know, have you got an issue there in terms of your recruitment and retention? Does that ultimately boil down to how much you're paying your people?
Yeah, pass to Vicky in a second. I recognise all that you say. That this, I think, I conveyed briefly in my opening remarks that we are operating in a challenging market to recruit and retain the necessary skills to deliver our services. So you'll see from the annual report that our turnover is about 9% at the moment. That's higher than we would have known before the pandemic. And there are a range of factors behind that we're seeing across society. About, you know, I think it's been referred to as the Great Retiral. So you know, we have lost some colleagues who have been with us for many years. We have replaced them, you know, with recruitment externally or internal promotions. One of the factors that we're not quite at, we haven't recruited entirely up to establishment yet either. So, and we have done a lot of recruitment over the course of the past year as well. Part of that is the aspects of growth that the Commission has supported us with. but there is also an increased turnover. Vicky can say a wee bit more. Mr. Johnson, the one point, just for absolute clarification, our pay award was 5% in the year rather than 2%.
Going by your median remuneration quoted in on page 51
yep.
of the... there's various reports you've got, but in the remuneration staff report, basically. So if I just don't... I mean, I understand what you're saying about the pay award, but if your median pay is only increased by 2%...
It's a little bit of a combination of reasons behind that. So we operate incremental pay scales, yeah. and there is a presumption that when people are promoted, they start on the lower end of the pay scale. So there's something of an
element... You take my point, is that I understand that these things all wash through, and sometimes the aggregate position can be different, yeah, and that can feed into your overall recruitment and retention.
Yes, it can, and Vicky will want to say a bit more, but even looking to the year ahead, so we're absolutely conscious that the context that we're in, you describe it yourself, that we're in almost double figures or slightly below in terms of pay and overall inflation rates.
Yeah.
There are circumstances of inflation as they apply to how people live that will be higher than that in terms of food inflation. And yet, referencing back to the meeting we had with the SCPA on our budget for 23-24, we have assumed a 3% pay award for the year ahead. We're not yet in formal negotiations with our trade union representatives, but you can see there is an element to bridge we can assume as to where we get to and how we reconcile all of that, plus the challenges of the wider auditing profession has in recruiting and retaining staff to deliver our work. These are all factors that we're closely managing, and indeed Alan might want to say a bit more about the board's keen interest in all this. So if you can tell, I'm going to pause for a second. I think Vicky might want to add, and I'm sure Alan can say a word or two more.
Yeah, apologies. I wanted to get the exact figure for you. So our people in post is 95% for this year, and that's the average over the year because we have been on that capacity building. So there has been some retirals and getting people in post, the executive team, and building that capacity. So we are down, but it's something that we're monitoring in terms of people in post percentage, but we think that will recover for 23-24. Page 51 you refer to, the pay award was 5%, and the figure maybe for 22-23, the average change was 5.5%, and that reflects the pay increments that staff would have got as well. But we agreed a 5% pay award with bottom loading for the most junior pay band, and as Stephen said, we're in negotiations with our union colleagues about the pay award for 23-24, so that pressure is not going away. But the pay award, the average pay is 5.5% on that page 51.
Yeah, but I mean, just to be very clear, median remuneration went from 45,197 to 46,226. That £1,000, give or take, delta is 2%. I mean, I understand these all are different cuts of the pie, but just I don't dispute, but that doesn't contradict the fact that I was just putting that there. In the interest of time, I think we need to move on. I mean, I understand all that. Can I just ask one last question about pension contributions? So I note, and this is... without wishing to sort of look to anyone around the table in particular, but I note in 22-23 that there was a £198,000 pension contribution made for Vicky Bibby, and likewise in the previous year, £144,000 pension contribution to Anthony Clark. Those are very high, certainly in comparison to annual salaries. And I will understand that there will possibly be technical reasons in terms of trends, but I would just be keen to get that on the record so that we understand what those are, what's going on there.
Thank you. You're right. There are technical reasons in respect of people who newly join an executive team that are leadership group that requires their disclosure in the remuneration report as individual remuneration, benefits in kind, or pension contributions. Stuart can say a bit more about this, and absolutely correct me if I don't give a clear enough description of this, Mr. Johnson, but we're in a defined benefit scheme that, to capture the totality of the value of it, there is a multiplier of around 20 to say what is the benefit that people get from being in that scheme. And that is reflected in the very first year that they join. So there is compliant with the financial reporting manual that public bodies follow, but it perhaps doesn't convey necessarily the most accurate description of what the individual benefit that a colleague receives. These are notional nonetheless, because they are defined benefit. This is if the person were to receive that benefit in its entirety this year, which of course they don't. That accrues over the lifetime of their membership of the scheme. So that's why, in both for Vicky's disclosure this year and Anthony Clark's last year, there's something of a skewing effect that's shown in the presentation. Stuart, have I captured that correctly?
That's correct, yeah. That's the methodology that we need to use as part of the accounts. It's the multiplier of 20, and it's to do with the real increase. The information we get from the pension fund is to say, well, this is the real increase from in the year, and then we need to use a multiplier of 20, and that drives that up to quite a high figure. When it comes to next year, that evens itself out and will be more reflective of some of the other numbers that you'll see in here. It'll be quite consistent. It's just that initial spike of the first joining of from the pension fund, just a disclosure that we have to make for the accounts.
Thank you. In the interest of time, I'll leave it there.
Thank you. And Mark Ruskell, what?
Yeah, you were mentioning earlier just about the great retiral trend across society and a number of retirals within your own organisation. I suppose to counter that, I noticed that you've got 48 trainees coming in. So I'm just interested, just briefly, about what kind of impact you think that's going to make to the organisation. And also, how do you retain those trainees? Because you could come into Audit Scotland and say, well, this is great, I can learn on the job here, and then actually I can take those skills and go anywhere really within the sector. So
yeah, good morning, Mr. Ruskell. Yeah, we do have we have 48 trainees who are working their way through primarily the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland training scheme to become a CA, hopefully upon completion of their training and exams. We also have some other colleagues who are working towards other accountancy exams. And just before I kind of develop my answer, we also have three modern apprentices in the organisation as well that are being supported through relevant training programmes. Our scheme is really twofold. One is that people who are working with us as trainees make an incredibly valuable contribution. So that they are doing audit work alongside their exams and study leave. They are part of both our annual financial audit teams and our performance audit teams, and they spend time in both sides of the business to deliver public audit. Upon completion, and I'll bring colleagues in just to say about the most up-to-date numbers we have about retention of people, not everybody stays. I think, and we don't assume that people will, but when we review the programme regularly, and again, Alan, you might want to say a bit more about the kind of board's perspective on this too, is that we understand that people will leave. We hope that they don't. We hope that they stay at Audit Scotland. But we hope that if they do decide to leave, they can make a contribution and broaden and develop their career in the public sector in Scotland. And we're seeing that many of our alumni are operating and working elsewhere in the Scottish public sector, delivering financial management, public audit, internal audit arrangements. And we think that's a largely sustainable model. So the impact is there, the contribution, and also to an extent the retention rates. But I'll just check if anybody has that. Martin, thank you, and then maybe Alan might want to say.
Yeah, Thank you, good morning. So in terms of the retention rate in the scheme, in 22-23, we were actually just short of 93% of people that stayed with us that had been on the scheme, which obviously we're very pleased about. Having said that, we also recognise that for those people that are on the scheme that qualify but then choose not to stay with Audit Scotland and perhaps move elsewhere, ideally within the public sector, then it's still a contribution, if you like. It's a good financial management within public service, even if it's not within Audit Scotland. But yeah, we do have a very high retention rate, actually, for the people that are going through that scheme.
I think, Chair, it is worth underlining the contribution that our trainee scheme makes to the audit profession generally in Scotland. It's a big cohort, and the cohort that we're we're going through at the moment have had it quite tough. You know, they had most of their learning done remotely for the better part of 3 years. And it might be of interest to the Commission if I just comment on the fact that we held our staff conference in March for the first time in 4 years, for the obvious reason. And one of the most impressive things was to see these trainees interacting with each other. Well, not quite for the first time, because Stephen had and Vicky had a session with them a month before. But they are very committed to us. But I underline the point that Martin makes. This is a contribution to, dare I use the phrase, public audit in Scotland, not simply to Audit Scotland.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, and I'll now bring in Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning. Key message number one in the report says we are making progress in returning the timeliness of our financial audit to pre-pandemic timescales, but have more work to do. Now, the figures, as I think I read them in the report, are that 2 years ago, the deliver to schedule number was 82%. A year ago, it was 75%. And in this report, it says it's 51%. So that doesn't sound to me like progress, but perhaps you could explain those figures.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Leonard. You're quite right. I think, as I alluded to in my opening remarks, this is challenging. By way of some optimism for the Commission's awareness, we are forecasting for the year that we're currently in that we'll be operating about 73% of the annuals or the annual financial audits will be delivered to timescales. Other context that's hopefully of interest to the Commission, we had the 51% and didn't operate to the same deadlines. So these were more challenging timescales. There was something of a relaxation of the target timescales during the course of the pandemic. So the local government audits, central government, NHS, all operated to extended timescales. And that reflected circumstances we've discussed at previous sessions with the Commission about the availability of audit evidence, some real emerging technical challenges, particularly in local government, around the valuation of assets that has taken longer, requires more evidence. And there's also other factors that we comment as well, just about the sequencing of availability of our audit work. With the exception of further education colleges that operate to 31st of July financial year end, all other public bodies in Scotland have a 31 March year end. So if there's if for whatever reason, either the auditor or the public body isn't available to support a particular slot that's been allocated, often what happens is it's not just deferred by a couple of weeks, it can drop to the end of a queue. So these are a variety of factors, but the results for 22-23 financial year, and as I say, a combination of audit years therein, we think represents the bottom of that delta of the delivery timescales and something of a legacy of the pandemic. Much more confident around the 73% that we're tracking for this year, and also a continuation of progress to recover to 2019 timescales. Last thing I would say about Mr. Leonard is that we're pleased with the progress we've made on audit quality this year, but we also recognise that timeliness of delivery is a component of audit quality as well. So both yourselves as parliamentarians and the public bodies, they want their audit signed off as quickly as possible. And we're working to make that progress this year and beyond.
Okay, thanks. I mean, you know, Professor Alexander in his opening remarks talked about the organisation considering our purpose. I think for most of us, we would consider the primary purpose is to carry out audits of public bodies. And it, you know, from these figures, it appears to not making the kind of progress that we would want to see. But can I just understand from you, Stephen, the extent to which this is timeliness issues amongst the bodies that you are auditing versus timeliness issues in your own organisation?
I think it's a combination of both of those things. So certainly there are more complex accounting and evidence factors. I've mentioned the valuation of local government property, plant and equipment has been a feature across UK government, across UK local government bodies. That has required more consideration. This year, in terms of from an auditor's perspective, we have had new auditing standards that have also required more detailed analysis consideration. Always a feature, Mr. Leonard, of new audit. It takes some time to bed in, regardless of how much preparation and training that we do with our colleagues. So that has been one of the features. And there's also an element of public bodies' ability to support the audit. So whilst we've had higher turnover, so have public bodies and their staffing arrangements to support the audit. And I think it's those factors, together with really the scheduling arrangements that we make for the delivery of audit. So as I mentioned, if a public body isn't available to deliver on time, or that there are factors that's causing the delay of the audit, that can knock out the timescales. So all of these are playing into really what we anticipate will be the bottom of that curve in terms of annual audit completion deadlines, and already projecting, I think, we'd be a stronger performance when we speak to you next year.
Do you know when you will get back to those pre-pandemic levels of completion?
So we're anticipating over the next couple of years we will return to the 2019 levels. As I say, it's never the circumstances in 2019 won't be the factors that are relevant in 2025. So that, you know, there'll be new technology that we're adopting, methodology is changing, as is accounting and auditing standards that are all relevant. I've omitted to mention some really complex accounting standards that have come in that are featured in our own accounts about disclosure of leases, for example, that have taken a lot of, you know, working through, and not to mention our pension disclosure. So having said all that, we anticipate with careful management we'll be on course for that over the next couple of years.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask you about best value auditing? On page 15, Audit Scotland reports that it has developed a new model of integrating best value into Council's annual audits. As the best value audits were performed as separate audit projects until this year, to what extent will the new model contribute to effectiveness and efficiency, not just for the audit teams, but also for the audited bodies?
So we think very much that will be the extent, and Vicky might want to comment a bit more about this in terms of the application of effectively the new code of audit practice that myself and the Accounts Commission have agreed that has evolved the statutory duty of best value and the associated audit arrangements in this new code, Chair. So you'll recall from previous conversations that, as you mentioned, the best value was a statutory audit arrangement that applied on a cyclical basis. So all councils would be subject to a best value audit at one point over a five-year appointment cycle. We've moved in now for this new year into the first year of the next five-year appointment round. But as best value has evolved, rather than being that standalone arrangement, which had real merit and real, you know, depth and evidence of scrutiny, that to strike the right balance between impact and evaluation, and fundamentally building on the knowledge that auditors have in the public sector in Scotland. So they don't just audit the accounts, they also apply the wider code. So they will be routinely examining financial management, financial sustainability, governance, leadership arrangements, and value for money, is that the Accounts Commission decided that they would evolve the best value auditing model into the annual audit arrangements, but still take the opportunity to have a more in-depth analysis on a rolling basis of a number of councils each year. So we're not anticipating any loss of impact through those arrangements, but rather really harnessing the expertise that the annual auditors will have and building on the wider code that we use to audit councils in Scotland to demonstrate the scrutiny effectiveness that will come from that process. Again, I'll pause in case Vicky wants to add anything.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen. I mean, a lot of it has been covered there. 22-23 saw the final round of the three remaining best value reviews completed for that year. But as part of the new code, which we're now in for the moment, it is part of the wider scope audit. That is new for councils. So there's been a lot of work the Commission has worked through with COSLA and SOLIS about people understanding the impact of that wider scope. But I think there's consensus that actually integrating it in best value into that wider scope will really pay dividends, but not diluted, but there will be additional best value reports. And the Commission, I don't want to speak for them, it's not my role to, but is will be monitoring the effect of this of that, but is quite pleased with how that is progressing. But the Accounts Commission do get regular updates each meeting on that.
Okay. Chair, one of the striking outputs from the consultation that I referred to earlier, which led to the publication of Public Audit in Scotland, was the degree to which auditors' bodies appreciate what they get from the wider scope audit. Clearly, they want a clean, clear audit in terms of propriety, but they also want us to use that as a platform from which we can help to improve the overall performance of the public sector. I was struck by just how strong that view was. When I joined the Board of Audit Scotland 4 years ago, there was a lot of talk about wider scope audit. And what's happened over these 4 years is exactly what Stephen and Vicky have mentioned, that a clearer integration of the propriety audit and the wider scope audit. And I think there's a lot of added value for the public sector, Scottish public sector, in the fact that we do both of these. And I'm absolutely convinced that having the best value audit almost in a separate box diminished the effect that we could have.
OK, thank you. Moving on to the property portfolio, page 34. Audit Scotland reports it began a review of premises to consider its future needs. Can you provide an update on the review of its use of premises and the likely timescale for completion of the review? And could you also explain why actual rent and rate costs were less than budgeted and show a fall from the costs reported in the previous year?
Yeah, many thanks, Chair. Maybe just pass straight to Vicky and bring Stuart in as well for that one.
Thank you. So probably like many organisations, the makeup of how our staff work has changed as a result of COVID. And as an organisation, we wanted to capitalise on the fact that our leases were coming to a point, so both in Edinburgh and with Glasgow. And the board were clear with us that we needed to maximise on opportunities such as the lease break, but also be cautious because I think, like many, we're not exactly sure what our future hybrid working will be. But I'll bring in Stuart for the detail. But looking at our staff makeup, we know that staff in the West, Glasgow offices, there's much more, you know, we've actually not got enough capacity for the way staff want to work. Tends to be more the financial audit staff who are more in the office and out at clients. So we are looking very closely at expanding our Glasgow office, offsetting it by potentially looking at reductions in the Edinburgh office. It's not all signed off yet, but actually there's a quite a significant saving in that as well, just with the property prices from the west compared to the east. So we wanted to have a saving as a result of this, but also meet the needs of what our staff are looking for. So it's been a careful balance and, as I say, looking at maximising those opportunities to to drive down our costs, but also meet the needs of staff. The costings of the rent are a lot to do with the change in IFRS 16, but Stuart has been leading on the property review and the accounting for rent, so I'll pass over to Stuart.
Thanks, Vicky. Yeah. In respect of the reduced cost, that's absolutely right. It's a new accounting standard, IFRS 16, it's called for leases. So originally, it was supposed to be adopted on April 2020, but due to the pandemic, it was delayed. So it was adopted for the first time April 2022. So we needed to account for it on that basis then. So effectively, you'll see in the analysis there is that there's a new disclosure called depreciation right of use asset. And effectively, that is where an element or the bulk of the element of the rental for accommodation is going in. We have to depreciate that as a right of use asset now under the new or under this accounting standard that was taken on board for the first time. Also included in there is the we also have car leases as well that are classified as a right of use asset. So you'll see as well that the travel and subsistence has reduced down as well as the rent and rates, and that is due to the accounting treatment with the costs now appearing under this new line, depreciation right of use asset. From what Vicky was saying as well about the accommodation, yes, I would think the Commission, we would be in a good position when it comes to the Commission's meeting for our budget proposal, that we would be clearer what our accommodation requirements will be. Subject to that, will be going to the board and as part of the budget proposal, so you will get a good idea of what our future plans will be in that respect. As Vicky said, the demand in Glasgow is a lot higher than in our Edinburgh office, and that is an element of the actual increase in numbers that we've had and the new staff that are joining. Actually, there are more now than pre-pandemic that have a Glasgow base. So, in effect, we've gone from around about 100 that had a Glasgow base, and now we're at about 130 have a Glasgow base. So that is where the demand as well is increasing.
Yeah, can I just comment on the way the board has approached this? And let me start by just referring back to a very long time ago when I studied Latin at school. And I learned that wonderful tag, festina lente, to hasten slowly. There was a tendency around, and I don't mean within Audit Scotland, I mean generally around, to grab this great benefit that hybrid working was going to produce for organisations. And my view, and I expressed this quite forcibly from the chair, was, look, we need to be sure before we make any changes, because we're going to look daft if we make changes and then have to pull them back 18 months from now. So we've now on the board had, I think I'm right in saying, three goes at it, and we'll have a final go and come to a conclusion in September. And just by way of broader comment, reading a piece yesterday in the papers about the decision of HSBC to abandon their signature building at Canary Wharf and move in to a smaller refurbished BT office in the city. And the first thing I thought when I read that was, I hope they don't live to regret that, because it just seemed to me to be a very big change. And I think any organisation has got to be careful. But there is absolutely no doubt, and anybody who has ever visited the Glasgow office, there was always going to be a need to increase capacity there. And we're now in the position where we may be able to balance the various parts of our rental estate in a way that will be medium to long term rather than grabbing a short term benefit.
Okay, thank you. I'll now bring in Mark Ruskell for his set of questions.
I was actually interested in the answer about what your staff think, because there are questions that organisations are having to consider now about whether, in the long or medium term, they move towards that and make a final decision on a lease. But I am really interested in what your staff and what your trainees think as well. What kind of workplace do they want to live in and work in going forward? But
we take the temperature of the staff on this quite often. I'll leave it to Vicky and Stephen to give you the detail. But I mean, there's no doubt that there is support for hybrid working. The problem is that each individual has a different definition of what the best hybrid for them is. So we have to try and navigate that and make it possible for people to work in a way which is acceptable to them and productive for the organisation. And I think that's why we've taken our time about this. And, I touch wood when I say this. I hope that the decisions that we'll make in September, and which we'll talk to you about a year from now, will turn out to be the right ones in the medium and long term. Stephen.
Thanks, Alan. I'm going to actually turn to Martin and Mr. Ruskell, actually, because he has led much of the staff engagement that we have done with our colleagues on such an important issue, that given the upheaval that we've all been through, and particularly, thinking about from my colleague's perspective about how we have audited over the past 3 years in a rapidly different environment than we were used to. So we've conducted our traditional surveys. So we still do our annual best companies survey. We have a stress survey with our colleagues alongside that. We've done a range of pulse surveys in between times just to, as part of our wider staff engagement. But we've specifically engaged with people on hybrid working arrangements. And you'll perhaps not be surprised to hear that there are mixed views. Some people are very enthusiastic about hybrid working, others equally so about almost remote working. And there's an equally sizable group of colleagues who want to be back in the office almost entirely. And we have to do our best to accommodate individuals' preferences, but also find the right model to deliver high-quality, effective, timely public audit arrangements. So those results are very relevant, and they're nudging us to, I think, where colleagues have suggested that we're getting to with our estates strategy that we'll engage with the Commission further on, of retaining high-profile, appropriate premises in Edinburgh, Glasgow, alongside the premises we have in Inverness and Aberdeen, I should say, but on as Vicky's mentioned, on a slightly different ratio of footprint in both Glasgow and Edinburgh. Martin.
Yeah, thanks. I think your question was very much around staff engagement. What do people think? What are they saying about that? And as Stephen said, we've got a range of surveys and various other engagement tools that we use to keep taping the temperature, because we're also conscious that opinions change. What people felt about hybrid working and what that might look like at a particular point in the pandemic has changed over time, as people experience both home working, but increasingly as people experience and reminding themselves almost what it's like to be in the office, to be working with face-to-face with colleagues, and some of the buzz that you get about that when people are actually together. We've got a developing hybrid working project, and there's a couple of key work streams in that. The estate strategy is one of those, which obviously we've spoken about, because that and working patterns are obviously inextricably linked. We've also got a work stream in there which is about the policies and procedures and so on, just to make sure that everybody's as clear as they can be around what the expectations are around hybrid working. And that project group, very helpfully, includes representation from across the business groups, but also from our PCS branch as well, who are members of that group. So we're keen to get that wide range of views in there. In terms of working practices, Stephen said it's around about sort of between 70 and 80% of folks that operate where they're in the office maybe a couple of days a week. And then we've got much smaller numbers of people at the extremes, with those who are very rarely in, and for those that are in the office all of the time. And that's not shifted hugely It's something that we've been tracking, but it's not changed fundamentally, although we are seeing slightly higher uptake in terms of office usage in recent times. So lots of processes have we got underway to really keep taping the temperature and see what people are feeling. And that includes the contributions of the meetings of the working group itself, of course, because there's lots of representatives from different areas of the business in there. Stephen said it does. There are some patterns in there whereby financial audit in the West places more demand on the office. And indeed, of course, people are out and about at audit sites more so than they were now as well. Whereas in Edinburgh, where it's more some of the kind of performance audit and support functions, where perhaps the office usage isn't as much and certainly wasn't as high as it used to be pre-pandemic. But we do monitor all that all very closely. And I think we're looking at a period now in combination where the estate strategy is by the autumn time this year, I think we'll be much clearer on what a more predictable future will look like in terms of hybrid working.
Okay, it's useful to get that temperature check in terms of what your staff feel. I mean, maybe if I could just sort of move on to another area then, which I think has come out of staff surveys. And that's, you know, we understand that the in-house teams, you know, have responded to surveys and have indicated that, you know, they perhaps feel that they don't have enough time and resources to complete the audits, and that's compared perhaps unfavourably with other firms that are operating in the auditing space. So I'm wondering to what extent you kind of recognise that, what you think the underlying reasons are for that difference between yourselves and others, and what action you think you should or could take on the back of that.
Yeah, but we absolutely recognise it. And our colleagues have told us that they would like to have more resource to deliver the delivery of audit work. There is something of a balance between, you know, our resources are finite, and we do want to make best use of those to deliver high quality audit within timescales. But it is a feature, as you say, and I think it's come out in both our staff survey and the quality survey results that are reflected in our Quality of Public Audit in Scotland publication. The differences between us and the firms, we don't have a detailed analysis of that. I think there is an aspect of comparing quite different cultures in an audit firm relative to a public body like ourselves in Audit Scotland. But we are taking it really seriously, and Vicky might want to say more about kind of our work in this area. I guess a couple of things I would add firstly is that we spend a lot of time thinking about, you know, where we go next in terms of our delivery models, our deployment arrangements, the innovation that we want to bring into the delivery of public audit. We used to have all of these arrangements spread across different business groups. We've instead moved to a model of an innovation and quality group. Innovation being said, how are we undertaking audits, the methodologies that we're using, the deployment arrangements, because I think sometimes we more regularly talk about resourcing rather than deployment, and how we are forming teams in the organisation is one part of that. So alongside the as Alan mentioned, the publication of Public Audit in Scotland and our corporate plan in the last couple of weeks, underpinning that is the business groups, their own business plans. And the real focus this year on is just cracking the resourcing arrangements that we have in Audit Scotland so that we can marry up delivering high quality, timely audits, but also so that colleagues feel like they have enough time themselves to deliver and contribute to the overall objectives. Is that fair, Vicky?
Yeah. Instead of just saying, well, we haven't got the time to do this, it's about, well, okay, how do we do this in a more efficient, more productive way? How do we marshal ourselves in a way that can deliver those
absolutely.
Benefits and reduce pressure? Is that kind of...
Yeah, 100%. That's their objective. And as maybe touched on a couple of times, is that the auditing profession is changing quite rapidly. So new auditing standards, new accounting standards, new technology is being brought to bear. You know, we're investing in, as we've talked about through an innovation and quality team, we have plans in place for new software to capture our audit work and our judgments. And all of these factors will contribute, we hope, to easing some of that pressure. There is something of a bit of an internal aspect to this, is that auditors desperately want to recover the timescales. So we know that teams want to get back to 2019 patterns and back on track is the phrase that we tend to use for good reason. We want to deliver timely, high quality audits. So it's the compressed nature of that. So I think I was explaining to Mr. Leonard, we think we're in something of a 2-year window here with which to recover that timescale and work through with colleagues application of methodology, technology, to ease some of that at the same time.
Mm.
Yeah. Just to add to that, I think picking up on a number of the aspects, that we've got a number of things to balance, getting back to a timetable, addressing the or meeting the new requirements on the profession, looking at how we also modernise as an organisation as well, of what, not just in year, but looking ahead, what does the auditor of 5 years look like, so we're on the front foot, and also managing that against staff wellbeing, which is absolutely vital. So it's what is the right balance, and it's discussing, we're in close discussion with our unions and with our staff, and that's why we place the importance on staff surveys. But very much linked to this is our new corporate plan and our business, and we've got a new business planning approach about where are we focusing our time to ensure quality delivery and impact, that positive impact. And having discussions with staff around the productivity and efficiency, what mechanisms or pieces of work do we stop doing because we're trying to balance off all these challenges that will maybe don't have the same impact on our work. So it's absolutely vital that all staff are involved in with delivering this new corporate plan, our business planning approach. But alongside that, it's not the people strategy and the financial strategy are absolutely key, and we're bringing all of those together. But we have to balance those aspects, and that's why Stephen was saying, taking that 2-year period of recovery, managing the innovation we want to do, the staff wellbeing, we believe is the right pace at which to do that.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks for that. That was useful. My last question is about the 80% good compliance target. What are your thoughts on that? Is that too low?
I think the first thing I would say, we're pleased with the progress we've made in terms of audit quality. I think going back a couple of years, we had a dip in some of our financial audit work at the start of the pandemic. We've invested in our audit quality framework and associated action plans to target specific findings, recommendations that we've had from quality reviewers. So this year we've seen an upturn. All of our performance audits met the required standards, and on a rolling basis, the annual financial audits have met the target. So whether it's, we think it's about right, 80%, there will always be factors that come out of an annual audit that's subject to review that might lead an external reviewer or an independent internal reviewer to reach a judgment that an audit has fallen below the good standard. There's a 4-point scale effectively that assessors use. 1 and 2, you're okay. A 3 or a 4, not so. We're pleased overall, Mr. Ruskell, with the progress. I think it's borne fruit, the focus that we've had on audit quality. And again, Alan has been at the forefront of the governance that we've had around audit quality, just to make sure that this is an organisational priority. Recognising, really, and I'll pass to you, Alan, in a second, but recognising that if the quality of our work isn't there, there's a huge credibility gap that we would have as an organisation. So in order to speak authoritatively to the Parliament, we have to be able to demonstrate that we are reliable in the judgments and the reporting that we are making. Alan?
I think it's worth just adding to that, that as part of the process of addressing the issues of quality that jumped up and bit us in 2021, Stephen has mentioned both on this occasion and previous occasions his a recommendation to the board, of the, which the board accepted, of having a new directorate for quality and innovation. That has been a major part of addressing this. But one of the things we've also done is to rejig the way in which the board receives information about organisational performance and indeed financial performance. And I think we're now in a position where we get a richer suite of numbers each time we meet, and both the audit committee in great detail and the board as the major governance body, and if you like, the long stop, has that as one of the key things that they have to examine on each occasion. I think I go along entirely with Stephen's point that, you know, 80% is good performance. We can probably do better than that, but it's very difficult to see how you get to 100% on this, because it's such a varied portfolio of things that we have to do and the time that we have to do it.
So you could go north of 80, but not up to 100 then? I mean, is this quite a blind metric, or should we be looking at something a bit more detailed within that, given the nature of the audits?
Yes, we do have the detail. So really, we have a programme of external quality reviews that are undertaken by our external quality assessor, which is now the Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales, who we appointed last year. They've gone through the first cycle. So something of a rotation from our previous provider, which was the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland. So again, a completely detached, separate evaluation of the quality of our work covers both performance audit and financial audit. We look to cover appointed auditors both within Audit Scotland, our in-house teams, and also the firms that we use. And you'll have seen from the quality of public audit in Scotland the scores that have been provided. Alongside that, we've got the in-house teams, both from the firms and ourselves, who are assessing it. To answer your question directly, Mr. Ruskell, it's my hope and expectation that we'll be well clear of 80%. But I think as a metric, it allows for the fact that we have scores of appointed auditors within the organisation, some undertaking a large portfolio of, you know, central government bodies, NHS and local government. But we also have managers within the organisation who are appointed auditors who audit smaller bodies. We think that's the right model that allows to support career progression to larger portfolios in future. But there is something of a, you know, there is with that an increased possibility that quality on some audits might fall below where we want them to. I think we are safeguarding that with the investment we've made in audit quality and some of the training that goes alongside that. So, as I say, we hope to be well clear of 80%, but allowing for the range of variables, we feel it's broadly the right target.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Do any members have any final questions? No. Daniel?
Before we convene. Yeah, so I just wanted to ask a couple of broader questions. So first of all, we've had the resignation of William Moyes from the Audit Commission. I was just wondering if there had been some use of this point in time just to sort of reflect on the fact that we've got these parallel structures, and certainly in terms of statute. But actually, if you know, I always reflect when I read your reports. I'm not sure someone coming fresh to your annual report would necessarily see that hard distinction. I mean, is there a discussion about how the two entities move forward in advance of a new permanent appointment? Certainly, from Audit Scotland's perspective, and how they interoperate.
Yeah, there's a range of points in there. Actually, I'm sure Alan might want to say a word or two about it as well. But I mean, Dr. Moyes handed his resignation, or wrote to the Minister in May. The Accounts Commission is a non-departmental public body, and by statute, Audit Scotland provides services to both the Accounts Commission and the Auditor General. As you know, Mr. Johnson, the SCPA decides that the Auditor General is the accountable officer of Audit Scotland. In terms of interim arrangements, the Scottish Government have appointed Ronnie Hines as an acting chair, and he's working closely with his Accounts Commission colleagues on future arrangements, and in due course the Scottish Government will be re-advertising for a permanent chair. In terms of all of the arrangements are set down in statute, there is legacy from pre-devolution, the 1973 Act for local government still applies to the arrangements for the Accounts Commission. When Audit Scotland was formed and the post of Auditor General with the 98 Scotland Act and the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000 sets out how the model operates. I think there's some certainty with the combined focus and attention in public audit in Scotland, our recent publication, that sets out how the model of public audit in Scotland operates. Where it's relevant, we have a shared ambition, we have a shared work programme, and to deliver high quality public audit in a way that public services are changing as well. So we come together when we need to, and we have a distinct identity when we also think that's most appropriate. But until there's a decision elsewhere, if that ever came, this model is how we have it, and we aim to make it to operate effectively. Alan?
Yeah, I think it's worth telling the Commission that before Bill Moyes resigned, we were already beginning a process of how we could improve the way in which this three-legged stool of the Auditor General, my board, and the Commission work. And that will continue. And Ronnie Hines has a brief to look at that in the period when he is interim chair of the Commission. But we are in this odd situation where, I mean, I could revert to my previous profession and tell you what I would do in terms of how to organise public audit in Scotland, but I'm not going to do that because I don't have the power and I don't have the locus to do that. What we do have is a commitment to modernising and refreshing a document that sets out how the partnership should work. And we're working on that at the moment. We would expect that to be completed, Vicky will correct me if I'm wrong, before a permanent chair is in place in the Commission, because the situation is such that we need to know with some clarity how these three bodies work together. And I think it can work. I don't know whether I would have designed it this way, but we're on the case.
I find it interesting that Stephen, you reflect on the Local Government Act 1973, and actually I think in some of our previous deliberations I sort of looked into this, and I actually was quite surprised at how distinctly different. So while the work that undertaken or under the auspices of yourself and your office and the Audit Commission are functionally the same, in terms of the accountability, they're very different, with the Auditor General being accountable to Parliament, where the Accounts Commissioner being accountable to the Scottish ministers. And I just wondered if it actually, while the sort of the nature of the day-to-day work, whether that accountability point is sort of just worth a collective thought and reflection, not just on your part, but on ours as well.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting point, and the word I would use to stress is independence.
Yes.
So the
small eye independence.
Quite. The Auditor General for Scotland is independent of government, and although I report to the Public Audit Committee, I'm free to set my own work programme. Again, the Accounts Commission is probably best placed to speak for themselves. And whilst they are a non-departmental public body, they operate independently from ministers, albeit they are appointed by ministers and do engage with ministers. From Audit Scotland's perspective, it's our role to provide high-quality audit work on behalf of myself and the Accounts Commission, both through the annual audit process and the delivery of a performance audit programme. But we can never take independence for granted, Mr. Johnson. I think that's the point, that we safeguard it very, very carefully. We've got a range of checks and balances, you know, through how we're assessing, you know, colleagues' independence, our ethical standards and so forth. But it matters that not just that we believe we're independent, but the Parliament, the public also see that both Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission is independent as well.
And can I just ask one final question? And I'm going to do a bit of a Daniel Johnson special and ask a very left-field question. I mean, I think we had some discussion about how different accounting treatments for leases has impacted your accounts. I think there's a number of quite challenging things coming down the line. There's been a lot of discussion about generative AI. There's also, I think, questions around carbon accounting. I'm just wondering kind of what your thoughts are collectively about thinking about some these sorts of issues, and not limited to those, and how they might impact your work in the future, and kind of how you're tracking, and do you have a sort of a radar, and is there any sort of you know, resource allocation to thinking about these sort of big things, potentially big changes?
Very much so. This is really wise after the event, perhaps, but the intention that Alan mentioned earlier, but really creating an innovation and quality department in the organisation so that we have the capacity to respond to the fundamental changes that are happening in society and the auditing implications around that. We've invested in digital auditing, but that's really only one part of it. You know, mm-hmm. So you quite rightly mentioned artificial intelligence. We don't know yet what that will mean for how we will audit, as Vicky talks about, you know, the auditor of the future 5 years from now, but we can safely assume that it will have fundamental changes. And we are keen that we're not reacting to some of those changes yeah. and developments. We hope that that will have a positive impact on both the depth of our work, the insight that we can bring to delivery of public services. So yes, we're tracking, we're monitoring it, we're engaged significantly with the auditing profession and the accountancy profession as well, so that our reach is, again, not just a reactive one. From a public audit perspective, we also want to have our voice as part of some of the developments in the profession. Public audit in Scotland's in a relatively strong place compared to some of the challenges that we're seeing in other parts of the UK in terms of the delivery of audit. We want to retain that position, and we see our work through innovation and quality as one of the ways we'll do that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any final questions? Mark?
No,
thank you. In that case, can I finish by thanking Professor Alexander, the Auditor General, Vicky, Martin and Stuart for their evidence today, and we will now have a short suspension while we change witnesses. Good morning, and I welcome to the meeting David Jeffcoat, partner, and Gillian So, audit and accounts manager from Alexander Sloan. And can I start by asking if you would like to make an opening statement?
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Chair, and the Commission. I would like to give a summary of our work to accompany our audit opinion and our audit summary report. Alexander Sloan was appointed to carry out the external audit of the financial statements of Audit Scotland for the year to 31st of March 2023. Our audit planning commenced in February, our audit work in early May, and I signed the audit report on the 12th of June 2023, and our audit was carried out in accordance with international standards on auditing. Once again, we carried out our audit remotely, using a variety of methods to do this effectively, such as a secure portal to request and receive information electronically, and screen sharing and video calls to make our work as efficient as possible. And I'd like to thank the attentiveness and responsiveness of Audit Scotland's finance team for their support in this approach. Our audit opinion is contained within the audit report in the accounts, and it confirms that the financial statements of Audit Scotland give a true and fair view as at 31st of March 2023, that they have been properly prepared in accordance with international financial reporting standards and the government's financial reporting manual, and in accordance with the Public Finance and Accountability Act 2000. For the record, I can confirm that adequate accounting records have been kept by Audit Scotland and that we received all the information and explanations we required before issuing the audit opinion. Our audit opinion also confirms that expenditure has been incurred and receipts applied in accordance with the PFA Act 2000. As part of our audit work, we are required to prepare an audit summary report to the management of Audit Scotland, and a copy of this has been sent to the Commission. The audit summary report summarises our response to key audit risk areas and, where applicable, reports on any weaknesses in the accounting systems and internal controls that may come to our attention during the audit. Our audit on management override considered the authorisation, appropriateness and accuracy of bookkeeping and accounting journals and related financial controls, and we identified no issues to bring to the attention of the Commission. Our audit work on revenue recognition considered the accuracy of recording income in the appropriate accounting period and is linked to our auditing of work in progress. Our audit work in this area concluded that the work in progress debtor balance and the work in progress creditor balance or deferred income at 31st of March 2023 were based on robust assumptions, accurately calculated, and we are satisfied they were accounted for appropriately in the financial statements. Our audit work on accounting estimates included consideration of provisions within the financial statements, and we are satisfied that the provisions contained within the accounts, including the provision for fee rebates to be issued to audited bodies, is appropriate and that the estimates have been accurately calculated. Sufficient disclosures have been made in the notes to the financial statements. Our audit work this year identified two adjustments to the draft financial statements, and these are noted in our audit summary report. These related to the accounting for leases and for pensions. I would like to record that in both cases our dialogue with Audit Scotland was constructive. We encountered no issues with our proposed amendments. Taking these in turn, our audit this year required a consideration of the recent adoption of an accounting standard in respect of the accounting for leases. Our audit work noted some amendments required to balances on the statement of financial position, though no effect on the reported net comprehensive expenditure. These amendments were agreed and processed, and I can confirm that we're now satisfied that the accounting for leases is appropriate and disclosures in the financial statements sufficient. Our audit this year also required an assessment of the reported pension balance. The actuarial report showed a surplus on the pension scheme's assets over the scheme's obligations. Where this arises, and following the accounting standard IAS 19 and guidance named IFRIC 14, consideration must be given whether this surplus represents a flow of economic benefit, namely a refund to Audit Scotland, or allows a reduction in future contributions. Further calculations from the scheme's actuary were requested to assess whether an asset ceiling applied to ensure there's no overstatement of the asset in the statement of financial position. Following these further calculations and by the actuary and our discussions with Audit Scotland's management, we are satisfied the accounting for the pension balance as nil in the statement of financial position is appropriate and that adequate disclosure in the notes to the financial statements is present. Our audit summary report is also an opportunity to propose recommendations to the accounting systems or financial controls in operation, and I can confirm that following our audit work, We did not identify any matters we require to raise to management or to the Commission. Finally, on behalf of me and my team, I would like to record our thanks to the staff at Audit Scotland for their helpful and prompt assistance during the audit. I'm happy to take any questions from members of the Commission. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I start by saying the SCPA welcomes the positive audit report received from Alexander Sloan, CA, and the unmodified audit opinion placed in Audit Scotland's 2022-23 annual report and accounts. And for completeness and for the official record, can you confirm that you have received all the necessary information and explanations that you require to form your opinion on the financial statements?
I can confirm that.
Thank you. And can you also confirm that you're content with the judgments made by Audit Scotland and the disclosure of these in the annual audit and accounts?
I can confirm that, yes. And often they're contained within the accounting estimates section within the financial statements, but yes.
Well, thank you. One final question for me. I wonder, you'll have heard the evidence earlier from Audit Scotland. The delays to completion of financial audits, is that something that Alexander Sloan is also experiencing?
As an audit firm, yes. I mean, I think actually it was interesting Stephen mentioned that there's a knock-on, possibly in 2021, actually, when there were delayed deadlines in 2020. So there were delayed deadlines for 2020 audits that knocked on to 2021. Now organisations are trying to get back into the old rhythm, so it is taking a little while for us to get back. So I probably actually echo what Stephen's saying about probably a year or two until we feel that we're back on track with our own audits.
OK, thank you. Can I ask that any other members have any questions? Daniel?
Thank you. So there was a fair bit of discussion about the new accounting treatments for leases and that accounting for quite a big decrease in things such as transport costs and so on and so forth. I'd just sort of be interested to know whether or not you feel that those have been treated adequately and whether or not those differences are ones that you'd expect given the application of the new standards.
Yes, so I mean, again, what was interesting is that there was no change to the net comprehensive expenditure figure. So what we looked at were things like prepayments. Prepayments are where you might pay rent, you know, in advance. That is no longer called a prepayment under IFRS 16. That's actually paying down a liability. So things like that have affected the statement of financial position. Within the statement of comprehensive expenditure, it was really just moving around. I don't know if you have sort of note four available. It was moving it, other operating expenditure note, moving it down from rent and rate. So the actual costs didn't change. It just was reallocated within that note.
So an accounting change, not a cash flow.
An accounting change, actually, yeah. Yes, yeah.
And are you confident that, you know, that this has all been applied as you would expect?
Yes. Again, in the initial draft, where that was in the accounts was slightly higher up in rent and rates. Mm-hmm. It was then sort of in this final draft in the signed accounts were reallocated down to what is now called sort of depreciation, sort of right in use assets. That's how it sort of comes in to the P&L, if you like. It comes in through that line.
Terrific. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any other members have questions? No. In that case, can I thank David and Gillian for their evidence this morning, and we will now move into privatisation.